皆さん、こんにちは。私はテレサです。今日は日本語能力試験について話したいと思います。もう一つの日本語能力試験についてのビデオやってたんですから、まだ見なかったらカードをクリックして見てくださいね。このビデオでは私の個人的な経験について話しました。今日は私の勉強し方を教えて、勉強資料を紹介したいと思います。このビデオは大体英語でやっていますから、これから英語にまたスイッチしよう。Hi guys, it's Teresa. Welcome back to my channel. Today, I'm gonna be doing part two in my little series about the 日本語能力試験, also called JLPT. And if you haven't seen my previous video where I talk about my personal experiences on the day, as well as a few tips on the before, you can go check it out. It's linked in the cards as well as in the description box below. But today I wanted to talk, as I said, about basically how I studied for it and also some tips for the individual sections, as well as show you the books I used to prepare. So for full disclosure, I want to first show you guys my actual scores of the N2. I think, you know, it's always good to take these tips with a grain of salt. I did try to implement them as best I could, but it wasn't always possible. I think by themselves, these tips are very valuable, but it doesn't mean that I like achieve perfect scores with them and that you can achieve perfect scores with them. Like, this is just gonna be like a general tip advice video, and I just wanted to like show you my score as well so that you can like decide how much salt you want to add to these tips, I guess. So first, let's talk about reading because I actually got full marks in that department and I'm so happy about it. I don't know how it happened, but I do believe that there are some things that I did right, apparently. And the first thing I think is to recognize that a lot of reading exercises are very, very similar, at least in the types of topics that they're about and the types of points and points of views that they're trying to express. So I've taken a standardized English test before as well, and even in preparation for that, as well as for this JLPT, I've noticed that a lot of the times the answers to the questions that they're asking you about the text are extremely self-explanatory, especially if the text is about a topic that is very, very widely discussed in broader society that's not necessarily specific to Japan or to any country, and that where everybody kind of has the same opinion on it. So, for example, if a text is about nature and like preserving nature, I believe that just by when you recognize what the text is about, a lot of the times you can extrapolate what the points, what the answers to the questions are gonna be because they're so generic. Just by having a sort of general knowledge of things and topics that are very widely discussed and that are very popular for these types of standardized tests, then you're gonna have a much easier time answering the questions and you're gonna have be much more capable of sort of skim reading the text, just kind of making sure that your presumptions of what it's trying to say actually match up. So oftentimes you don't even need to understand certain words in the text, I believe, if you're just able to be like, okay, which answer just makes the most sense? Like, is the most logical based on my previous knowledge of these topics. Especially since time is definitely a commodity that you are going to be very short of on the test. I personally was able to finish that first entire section ahead of time. I think I had about 10 minutes left to actually check my answers. But as far as I've heard, that is very rare. And you know, you would do best to try and like really work through everything as quickly as possible. I think that this is one of the methods that you can do that best. Next, I wanted to talk about the listening section, which for me, I felt like on the test day I had the most issues with. It turned out I had a little bit of a better score there than I did with vocabulary and grammar. But at the end of the day, I still felt very not confident, basically, of my performance, I guess, that day. The first thing is that obviously you have the listening section after the rest, so you're already kind of tired and sort of starting to lose your focus and starting to lose your concentration. So that can be really detrimental, obviously. So you have to work really, really hard, really try to focus yourself. And there were two things that really were very distracting to me during the exam. The first were the kanji on my answer sheet. Now, if you are somebody like me and you, I mean, most people, I think, if you look at something, you can't help but read it. And especially if it's kanji and you like conjure up the word in your mind as you look at a kanji, while you're trying to listen to somebody tell you important information, That can be extremely detrimental. So make sure, if you're like me, do not look at the answer sheet on the kanji. Like, I had to actively force my eyesight away, and I was like trying to look out the window or something at nothing, just so I could use my full brain capacity to focus on at what I was listening to. Definitely try to like exclude as much distractions as you can, because it's already so difficult that, you know, anything, any other slight distraction could be detrimental. Another point that I think is really important is that there are some sections of the listening exam that you need to be taking notes, because it's confusing what they're telling you. Like, they will use a lot of words that are conflicting meanings, and they will try and sort of confuse you as much as possible. So you do need to take notes. I find it really difficult to take notes when I'm trying to, at the same time, trying to process what I'm hearing, especially in such a foreign, still quite foreign to me, language. And so what I tried to do is I was writing on my paper, but I tried to not look at what I was writing, because again, I was sort of just like transmitting stuff to my hand, but not focusing so much on what I was writing. So obviously I was writing like in really ugly font and not in a straight line at all, but just like all over the place, but it didn't matter because at least I could focus. Again, I was not looking at the words, I was looking into nothing, and thereby sort of taking one extra distraction out of it, and that helped me focus more on what I was hearing. At the same time, it did impact the ability to actually go back and read my notes a little bit, because they weren't really structured well. So there's always like a plus and a minus to all of these things, I guess, a lot of the times. But that was sort of what helped me the most, I feel like, in the moment. And this is also something in retrospect I would probably have studied more. In general, I should probably mention that I didn't really practice listening at all. I was only like watching TV shows and stuff to sort of prime my brain better for comprehending Japanese, but I didn't actually actively practice the tests. So I think that's definitely something that you shouldn't miss out on if you can avoid it, because I think it's really, really helpful, especially practicing this note-taking while listening, and trying to make your notes as comprehensive as possible while writing as little as possible actually down. Because also after the listening, like, you don't have a ton of time to sort of study your notes or like make sense of them. You literally need to answer immediately. So it's very, again, you're very strapped for time, and you need to make spur of the moment decisions on your answers, and you can't really like think too much about it. So that's definitely something that you should be ready for. Another thing with listening I think that's really important is to train your brain to not be freaking out as soon as you don't understand something. I think this is especially relevant in a test situation where you're already nervous and then you're like scrambling to understand everything, and then you don't understand something and your brain's like, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, I don't understand this, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god. And then obviously while you think all those oh my gods, you don't actually pay attention to what you're listening to, and you understand even less. And then this is just like a vicious cycle that can turn into you having no clue whatsoever of what's currently being said. This applies to every language, I believe. Like, all languages that you don't fully understand and like intuitively understand, your brain sometimes can really easily start to freak out at that non-comprehension. So I think it's very important to train your brain to listen to stuff that you don't fully understand and be okay with it. You don't need to sit in a listening exercise or like in a listening exam and fully understand every single word that's being said. That is not necessary to understand the whole picture. Of course, there's some words that are more important than others to understand, but I think as long as you get the overall picture, you're gonna be fine. When you're practicing for the exam and when you're taking the exam, try to focus on understanding the bigger picture. Try to understand what is the situation, who is talking, what is their relation to one another, what are they talking about, like what is the overall picture, and then sort of infer from that and deduce from that what actually is like the point of the question. If you can read the question ahead of time, obviously it's gonna be easier because you can like look for specific things. But just in general, try to focus not on like one specific word that you're hearing. Try to focus on understanding the meaning of what you're hearing. And that's sort of like a little shift that you need to make in your brain, but I think it's really, really important. And it's really important to start training yourself for that early on. so that you don't freak out at unknown words. You can practice this not just by studying specific listening exercises, but also by just listening to things in Japanese in general and try to like keep your mind blank. Try not to like actively do anything with the knowledge you're given. Like, I know it's very intuitive often to like repeat single word, like individual words, and be like, oh my god, what does this mean? What does this mean? What does this mean? Just let it go. Just sit there and let the sound wash over you passively and like a net, and just try to collect as much meaning as you can. You don't need to focus on words, just collect meaning. And I think when you train yourself to do that, you're gonna do much better at exams like that, and just in general at understanding. You're gonna be much better, and you're gonna be less freaked out when there's a word that you don't understand. One last thing for the listening section is, I would say, practice with the book for the level above the one that you're taking the exam at. This was a tip that my friend gave me, because the practice listening exams in the N2 book are a lot easier than the actual N2 listening exams, and so it made a lot more sense for me to practice the N1. As I said, I didn't really study that and practice that, but I just thought I'd pass this tip on to you, because I think when you're used to much more difficult content, you're gonna have obviously a much easier time on the easier stuff. Duh. That turned into a longer segment than I intended it to be, but now let's jump into the grammar vocabulary part, which was my least good result. This is one that I think is very difficult to prepare for, because it's extremely arbitrary. You have essentially a very small collection of questions that you're being asked out of an enormously long catalog of possibilities. And that's really the crux of the matter. Like, that's the problem. Because you can't fully know all of it, probably, unless you're a genius. And so if you're unlucky, you get a lot of words that are in the section that you don't know, basically. I think this is the section that really just comes down the most to pure and basic studying. Like, studying vocabulary, studying grammar, making sure you understand the differences between things. On that note, I also wanted to add that if you are not just taking this exam because you need the certification, but it's because it's something that you want to do for yourself, you want your own skills to improve, and you want sort of like a tangible proof of that, then I recommend not just studying with the multiple choice system that they give you both in the practice books and obviously in the actual exam, but to actually take your time and familiarize yourself with the vocabulary and the grammar. Because in reality, shocker, actual language knowledge and use has nothing to do with multiple choices given to you, and you just need to pick one. And so just because you're capable of picking the right meaning to a word out of four offered meanings doesn't mean that you're actually able to use that word in a meaningful way and in actual real life situations. So don't just practice for the test, but practice for yourself, practice for your own language skills and your own knowledge, practice to improve. Try to use the words that you're learning. Try to question what you're learning. Try to think like, okay, wait, I heard this seems familiar. I think there was another thing that was similar. Okay, these two have the same meaning. And then go out and use them and figure out where their differences lie. Ask a Japanese person, ask a teacher, try to find out about it on the internet. Like, just do the work, and I guarantee you're gonna remember these words much better, and you're gonna be actually able to use them, because just based on the N2 or like just based on the JLPT, you won't. This actually goes hand in hand with another suggestion I have, which is to sort of found like a Benkyokai or like a study group where you can sit down with other people who are possibly studying also for the exam or sort of just for themselves, but just so that you have other people, first of all, to motivate you and also to discuss questions with. From personal experience, I can 100% say that grammar points or words that I've actually discussed with other people that I've had like questions on, and they were like, okay, well, does this mean, can I use this in this situation? Does this mean the same as this? Is this interchangeable? Is there a different nuance? As soon as you have that setting around the word where you're discussing it and talking about it and thinking about it in more complex ways, and you're trying to actually form your own sentences with it, you're gonna remember it so much better than if you just read it and its meaning on a page once or even 10 times. You can read it 100 times, and I guarantee you won't remember it as well and as sort of contextually relevant as you would if you actually like spend time on it. And so I think my recommendation would also be to study vocabulary and grammar slowly. Start sooner than I did. Start maybe a year ahead or half a year ahead and just spend time with each and every thing that you're like not 100% sure of how to use and try to figure it out, because it's not only gonna allow you to do better on the exam, but more importantly, it's gonna allow you to actually use those things in real life and recognize those things for what they actually are. And it's gonna be infinitely more valuable than a piece of paper that you get because you checked the right box a couple of times. So now I'm going to show you a few of the books that I use to study. I use pretty much the same line of books, so I didn't have like anything else. I just used these. These are the Shinkansen Master for the N2. They have these for every level, I believe. So as you can see, I used D3, and then I used a little bit of the N1 for listening. I borrowed that from a friend. Of these three, again, mainly these two. This is the vocabulary book, and then this is the grammar book. So I'm gonna start with this one. This is the grammar book. I really liked it because it groups the grammar points that you need to learn into different sections based on what they're trying to express, like the purpose that they're fulfilling. And I think that that's obviously much easier to remember and like to learn them all in one place kind of thing. And then it gives you the point, and it also, it gives you an explanation also in Japanese. And then you have a couple of example sentences. At the end of every single chapter, you also have a multiple choice test. You will have like 5 points, each corresponding to one of the five that you learned about in the previous lesson. And then the last point will be sort of combining them. So this is obviously a much more realistic way of testing, because you're not going to be told, oh, these questions are all about the same grammar point. I will say that sometimes it doesn't explain nuances enough, which I find a bit frustrating, especially if you have like a very similar grammar point and it literally has the same explanation underneath it, like almost word by word the same. But then I went to ask Japanese people, they're like, yeah, but this used in different situations. And I felt kind of frustrated that this book wasn't telling that to me. But I don't think it's that big of a deal. I think, you know, in general, you would have to do this book by itself is probably not going to teach you like everything, but I think it works really well, and I personally really liked it. Then we have the vocabulary book. It's just called Goi, and this book again works very similarly. It has different chapters, each of which focuses on a different topic, and then it just kind of gives you vocabulary pertaining to that topic. And then at the last page in the chapter, you have I think 4 exercises that are actually like, again, modeled after real exercises in the exam. And the last book that I used as well, this is this Dokkai one. This is for reading exercises. I didn't really study a lot with this because, again, I feel like if you take standardized tests a lot or you're very familiar with that format, then you're not going to have a problem because they all kind of function the same way. But this book actually gives you like different kinds of reading exercises, or it explains to you how they like structure the, or like how they pick the texts that they give to you and how they pick the questions that they want you to answer. So there's like different sections in the first part of the book where they literally explain to you like, this is how reading exercise can look like, and then this is what we want you to do. And then the last book I wanted to quickly show you is this kanji book. I didn't actually use this to study, but it's another book that I own. It's also for the N2, and I used this while I was in Japan to learn kanji. And to close out the video, I want to reiterate what I said in my Cambridge certificate video about standardized testing, which is this. Standardized tests are not capable by their very design of perfectly 100% reflecting your actual language skills. They are always only an indication, an estimate of where your actual skills are at, and they definitely can be a good indicator of that, but they're also not, definitely not reflective of your actual skills that you're actually able to use as well. This is especially true for the JLPT because it doesn't test for active language skills at all. There's only passive knowledge. You only need to recognize things and tick the correct box, but you will never ever once even required to frame your own sentence or to speak a sentence or anything like that. And so that already diminishes its value, I believe, in terms of what it's able to actually say about your skills. So even if you do receive full marks on the N2 or even on the N1, you could still be completely incapable of holding an everyday conversation in Japanese because those two are not related. As I said, it's an indicator, but it doesn't mean as much as I think many people believe it does. At the same time, even if you fail your test, you could still be very much capable of having conversations, talking to people, even maybe sort of discussing more complex issues than just like, how are you? I'm fine. It does not fully represent your knowledge and your skills, and it's very important to make yourself aware of that. In real life, there's so many more elements to like knowing a language and speaking a language well. It also, like, for example, includes cultural knowledge and knowledge and situational knowledge and stuff like that that is completely ignored in tests like these. And I know that that's for a reason, but I think still it's important to remember this and to make yourself aware of this, because otherwise you might make yourself crazy, especially if you feel like you failed at the test or you're like, you didn't do well enough. Just my opinion. You can let me know yours, but that's what I think. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please give this video a like and subscribe, and I will see you very soon with another video. Until then, have a lovely week. Bye.